Welcome everyone. With this session, we are going to start second module of our syllabus. The name of the module is Mobile Communication Generations. In this module, we are going to see three generations of mobile communication: second generation, 2.5G, and 3G. So starting with second generation, in this particular session, we will see introduction to the second generation called as a GSM and services offered in this GSM. So let's begin. What is GSM? So GSM, previously known as Group Special Mobile, founded in 1982. Now it is revised to the name Global System for Mobile Communication. In 1992, this renaming process completed. Now it is known as Global System for Mobile Communication. As I said, this is a second generation of mobile communication system. So which was the first? The first generation systems were analog mobile communication systems. Analog mobile communication system means they used analog signals for communication. Now from this second generation, digital mobile communication system started. So GSM uses digital signals for communication rather than analog. GSM is now most widely used and most successful mobile communication system in the world. Today, all over the world, more than 219 countries in several continents use the GSM services. More than 4.2 billion subscribers in more than 700 networks are currently availing this service from GSM. If you compare this GSM with the other standards, more than 75% of digital mobile phones use the GSM. So GSM is most popular and most widely used digital mobile communication system in our era. We are currently using fourth generation of mobile communication system in India. This is the second generation. So you can see how we have evolved over the years. So let's look at what are the advantages or performance characteristics of GSM with respect to the previous generations, that is analog systems. So talking in terms of communication, as we all know, this is a wireless type of communication. GSM is apart from being wireless, it also provides the mobility to the user to roam around anywhere while communicating with the other party. Not only it supports voice communication, but it can support data communication also. So that was absent from the analog systems. Okay, now as I said, you can roam around anywhere. It provides total mobility while communicating. Now, total mobility means your mobility is not restricted to particular area. You can take your portable device anywhere, anytime, and use different service providers to make a communication. Even you can move out of your country and still be able to communicate. That was the primary goal while developing the GSM system: to enable the user to roam around the world and still able to communicate using a single number. Okay, so because of this, it provides the worldwide connectivity. A same identification number, or in general use, we call it as a mobile number, can be used for making a communication. So locating that user and making the communication possible is a responsibility of a network infrastructure. Okay. So although name is a mobile communication, it is not completely wireless. The communication from a user till the tower, in general life we call it as a tower, in technical terms we call it as a base station. So communication from user to base station is wireless, so that user can roam around anywhere. But since from base station, entire communication will be wired one. So you need a fixed infrastructure to provide mobile communication system, that is GSM. So worldwide connectivity is possible because of different such infrastructures present all over the world, accepted worldwide, using single number. If you compare the capacity of the GSM with the previous generation, that is analog systems, it has a better frequency reuse efficiency, it has smaller cells and more customers per cell. Meaning is, More number of frequencies are available for users for communication because of better reuse of frequencies available in the system. Okay, as cells are smaller, the strength of signal which is received by the user is much better compared to the analog systems also, because strength of a signal is directly proportional to distance, directly proportional to 1 upon distance. It is better to have smaller cells, and that's why GSM prefers smaller cells. As we know, as we have seen in the end, at the end of a last session, more customers per cell, that is your channel capacity, is achieved in GSM compared to analog systems. That provides a better bandwidth to the users as well for communication. Since this is a digital mobile communication system, the audio quality and communication quality in this particular system is high, very high compared to analog systems, whereas phone calls at higher speeds can be made because of uninterrupted services provided by GSM. So even if you are in a car or a train, you are moving at a high speed, you can still make uninterrupted calls using GSM. Not only that, the major challenge while providing wireless communication is securing the communication, that is providing security to communication. So GSM has also provided authentication, encryption, access control, and several other security parameters for making the communication secure. So all in all, it is a complete package for providing a mobile communication system. No system is completely foolproof, so GSM also has certain limitations or disadvantages. The first disadvantage is being end-to-end encryption of user data, which is absent in GSM. Now, what do you mean by end-to-end encryption? Most of us now use WhatsApp for chatting. There you will see a message, your chat with this message is end-to-end encrypted. End-to-end means from one user end to another user end, the data will be encrypted. So why it is not provided in GSM? It is the older version of mobile communication system compared to current version, in that the data was encrypted from user to the base station, but at the servers, that is at the base station, that data was decrypted and transferred over the fixed network. And again, when it reaches the destination base station, it is again encrypted and transferred over the destination user. So from base station to user, the data or voice will be encrypted, but behind the bars, that is within the infrastructure, the data will not remain encrypted. So whatever you are talking is safe through the air, but it is not safe, or it is not hidden from the servers. Servers can easily listen to your voice or easily read your data. So end-to-end encryption means what? When data is encrypted at one sender's end, it will only be decrypted by the receiver's end. So even server cannot decrypt that data. But such facility is not available in GSM. The second limitation or disadvantage will be, it is not using the entire bandwidth of 64 kbps. which will not be available for the user. So ISDN, that is Integral Service Digital Network, which is a telephony network, digital telephony network, which is a wired network. It has a bandwidth of 64 kbps, but its entire bandwidth is not available for the user. How fixed telephony network is associated with GSM, that we will see during the architecture of GSM. Okay, so but that entire fixed network bandwidth is not entirely available for the user. Then third is a side effect of having this facility of using the GSM services while driving is that a driver may lose the concentration, that may lead to accidents. So that is a side effect of using this higher facilities. Okay, apart from that, another side effect will be the electromagnetic radiations which are carrying these signals from one user to base station and towards the receiver these radiations can affect human health also. So too much exposure to the electromagnetic radiation can be injurious to human health also. So it is avoided, although it is restricted so that it will damage or affect the human health to a minimum level, still it is affecting the human bodies. Then the next disadvantage can be, as I said, the data is not end-to-end encrypted. The abuse of private data is possible. So your message may be encrypted over the air, that is during you and the base station, that is tower. But at the server end, that data can be readable. So sending sensitive information like your account information, bank account information, or your passwords of a mail account, that can be very dangerous because that can be readable by the servers and may be leaked through the servers also. So abuse of private data is possible. And because of so many services offered by GSM, the infrastructure required for GSM is highly complex compared to previous analog systems as well. So these are some of the disadvantages. There are several other also, but these are the main disadvantages of second generation digital mobile communication system, that is GSM. So remember, GSM is a 2G system. Okay, so let's see which are the services that GSM is offering. GSM offers several types of connectivity, that is voice connections, data connections, messaging services also. We will see them one by one. Also, it can offer combination of voice and data, or combination of messages, combination of audio and messages. Audio messages can be also sent. So this type of services are basically divided into basic three domains, that is bearer services, telemetry or telematic services, and supplementary services. Okay, on your screen you will see basic components of this GSM system, where on the left hand side, this is a sender. This is a sender, that is transmitter, and let's say this is a receiver. Transmitter is a mobile user or GSM user. It consists of MS, that is mobile station. Mobile station composed of main two parts. One is a handset and another is a SIM card. Okay, so these are called as terminal equipment, TE, and mobile terminal, that is MT. These are connected to each other via R and S interface. This mobile handset is connected to or attached to the base station, that is our tower, through a wireless interface UM. Then this GSM base station is connected to a fixed wired network, which is a public telephony network called as public land mobile network. This is a interconnection of wireless communication system with the wired communication system. So it is connected to GSM PLN interface. Then this transition from mobile to fixed telephony is carried through transit network like public switching telephone network and integral services digital network towards the destination. That means when GSM call is initiated by the user, first it is transferred over to the base station. GSM will be transferring that call to the destination via certain internal infrastructure. If that destination, that is receiver, is a landline phone, this call initiated by a mobile user has to be transferred to the fixed wired telephony network, and that is our transit network, PSTN or ISDN. This transit network can be analog like public switching telephony network, or it can be digital also, that is integral service digital network. So that's why we had said previously it is not using entire bandwidth of 64 kbps of ISDN. So this is a transition from mobile to fixed network, that is landline network. Okay, so that transit network is there, and then we reach towards the source or destination network to which the receiver is attached. So it's a local network to which telephone, or it is called as telephone exchange, we can call it. This is, let's say, telephone exchange. This is our telephone exchange where our landline phone is attached, and this is our receiver. Okay, so as you can see, there are two services which are shown over here. One is bearer service and another is tele service, that is telemetry or telematic service. Bearer services are those services which are handled or services offered to the internal infrastructure like GSM, transit network, or source or destination network. The communication can be reverse also, from landline to mobile phone also, that can be also possible. So in both cases, same diagram is applicable. And the tele services will be services offered to end users like mobile user or landline user. So tele services are user available, while bearer services are infrastructure available. Okay, so let's see them one by one. Starting with bearer services. These services provide transfer of data between different access points. Access points means our base station. If call is initiated from a landline, the data or voice transfer from a local exchange to the end user. End user, if it is mobile, then it's base station. So let's say end user is mobile user and initiating user, that is calling user, is a landline user. Then voice or data transfer between local exchange and the base station, that is tower of a receiver, that connection or data transfer or voice transfer is known as bearer service. This specification of these services is up to the terminal interface that we are called what we call SIM card, that is our terminal interface, that is OSI layer 1 to 3, that is physical data link and network layer. Okay, so as we know, physical layer is responsible for transmission of data into raw bit streams. It comes into the picture. Data link layer is responsible for channel allocation and several other things, and network layer is for routing the call to appropriate user. So these three layers will be using the bearer services. So bearer services permit transparent and non-transparent type of service, that is visible to the everyone and also hidden to everyone, that can be also possible, or synchronous and asynchronous data transmission is also possible. Synchronous means it will require to communicate or transfer the data within specific time limit, or it can be asynchronous, like it can have no time limit but it will have start and stop bits for transmission of voice or data. So transparent bearer services only use the functions of physical layer to transmit the data. So what they are using, it is using FEC to improve transmission quality. As this is a digital communication system, it will have a better quality. So one technique it is used is forward error correction, FEC, which is using redundant data for transmission to improve the quality. So if you have a certain number of bits which is to be transmitted, let's say like this, some of those bits, let's say this is the one of the important bit, it will be transmitted not only once but several times. So even if during the transmission or during the destination towards the user, if it gets corrupted or if it gets lost, there are several other bits available from which information can be retrieved. So it is avoiding the error in the transmission quality. So that's why it is called as forward error correction. So even after that, if information bits are lost, then it is not possible to recover them. That is the drawback of this FEC. So transparent bearer services uses this kind of technique for improving the transmission quality, whereas non-transparent bearer services uses protocols of layer 2 and 3, that is data link and network, to implement error correction and flow control. This is also for improving quality of the communication. like radio link protocol RLP, which works on the mechanism of HDLC, that is high level delta link control, it is used, or selective reject mechanisms to trigger the retransmission of erroneous data is used at layer 2 and 3 for improving the transmission quality, that is voice quality or data quality. So these are the bearer services. So this is all happening internal. You will not see any user involvement in these services. So these are bearer services. So what are the data rates achieved for these bearer services? Based on synchronous or asynchronous, the data rates are variable, right from 1.2 kbps kilobits per second to 9.6 kbps it is possible. For synchronous, data rates are higher because your overhead of synchronizing bits is much lesser compared to asynchronous, because there will be header, tail, trailer, start bits or stop bits involved. So for asynchronous, we achieve data rates up to 300 to 1200, that is 1.2 kbps, 300 bits per second to 1.2 kbps. For synchronous, we achieve much higher data rate, up to 9.6 kbps. Although in this age, this seems very small data rate, because we are currently in a LTE world, fourth generation, where data rates are supposed to be in the megabits per second. At that time, when this was introduced, this was considered as very high data rate, and data rates of approximately 50 kbps will also possible, which will be covered later with new modulation techniques. Okay, so kbps, although right now it seems very small, at that time that was very high data rate. So this is about bearer services. Now let's move to the teleservices. As I said, teleservices involve user communication. So it enables voice communication via mobile phones, that is our mobile handsets and SIM cards. So provision of high quality digital voice transmission offering a traditional bandwidth of 3.1 kHz, which is ISDN bandwidth, although it is not entirely used. The user is provided with the extra services apart from normal conversation, that is like emergency number. For example, the common number throughout Europe is 112. You can dial this number even when your keypad is locked. Even when your keypad is locked, if you press 112 on your keypad, it will be able to call. You will be able to call to one emergency center location. It is mandatory for all service provider, and it is also free of charge. This is also the highest priority connection for voice communication. It also predeems or it oversees most of the other connections also. So because that's why it is emergency number. So in case of accidents or crisis situations, you can dial this number and no charges will be applicable. So for that reason, this is teleservice that is provided by GSM. It was not present in the previous versions. Then there are non-voice teleservices also, like fax, that is called as group 3 fax. Then mailbox, when you are not able to receive a call, then you can ask the caller to drop a message, voice message onto the mailbox. Voicemail it is called as. Then emails, okay, that is also possible through the teleservices. SMS. SMS is a 160 character short message that can be sent from a mobile handset using the channels of the mobile communication system. Then EMS, that is enhanced messaging service, and MMS, which is a combination of text message which is used in SMS, and audio or small animation also. So in video is also possible in MMS. MMS is the largest version of the short messaging services. In SMS we can send only text data. In MMS we can send several combinations: audio, text, video, and so on. Okay, so these services are also provided by GSM. So this is about teleservice. Then the last is supplementary services. These are not mandatory but are provided by most of the service providers. These offer more than just a pure calling or messaging or internet service. So what are the different supplementary services? this vary from different service provider, but most of them provide all of them. So like caller ID, that is who is calling, that we get to know from our mobile screen. Then we can forward our call, call forwarding or call blocking, it is also possible. We can forward our call from one SIM card to another SIM card if our SIM card is not in network area. Then auto reply, that is automatic callback, that is also supplementary service. Then call conferencing, that is also supplementary service. Up to 7 participants are possible in a simple audio call conferencing. Then if you lose the data, then we can avoid stealing of our personal information by locking the mobile terminal. If we find that our handset is stolen, then we can call the customer care and ask them to lock our terminal. So that is also provided by the GSM. So these are the supplementary services. So basic, these services are available with all the second generation GSM service providers. Okay, bearer, tele and supplementary service. So this is all about GSM introduction. From the next session, we will see the architecture of GSM and different components involved in it. That's all for today. Thank you.